I'm standing by the very first scene of the Bayeux Tapestry, and it's a telling image. It sets in motion a sequence of events and intrigue that can only be resolved by William's invasion of England. The tapestry tells us that Edward the Confessor offered William the crown because he liked Normandy, and William was his cousin. Harold Godwinson, his rival, wanted to be king, but the Godwin family was distrusted by Edward. As if to snub Harold, Edward sent him on a humiliating errand to Normandy to tell William that he was in line to be the next King of England. When your gaze fixes on Edward, you could almost believe that he knew the trouble that he was causing by asking Harold, of all people, to deliver this message. You can see in the picture that the person behind Harold is pulling a horrified face, realizing just how obnoxious this task is going to be to someone who believes that the throne is rightly theirs. So William had been led to believe that Harold was out of the running. But now the plot thickened, as over the following years, the Godwinsons used every trick to crawl before Edward and flatter him. Anything to win back the crown. And in January of 1066, that seems to have been just what happened. The old king falls into the arms of the Godwinsons, who by now have wormed their way back into his favor. He dies, and the next thing we know is that we find Harold on the throne with the orb, the crown, and the scepter, looking every inch the new and the Anglo-Saxon King of England. William was out hunting when the news arrived, and the chase was called off abruptly. For him, what had happened over in England was a double betrayal of faith. First from Edward, who'd promised him the crown, and then from Harold, who'd seized it. Writing here at the Abbey of Jumièges, William's biographer gives a vivid eyewitness account of just how badly William felt cheated.
When the Duke learnt the truth, how that Edward was dead and Harold made king, he became a man enraged and left the woods. Oft he tied his cloak, and oft he untied it again, and spoke to no man, nor dared any man to speak to him.
William would have his vengeance. Through the summer of 1066, he rallied the Norman nobles, still under oath to him. A fleet was built and supplies gathered. 6,000 horses, 2,000 knights, and 400 ships, their masts like a forest of trees. By August the 10th, the vast armada was ready. Across the Channel, Harold, the new Saxon King of England, waited for William on the south coast. And then the plot took its final, unexpected twist. A third contender, the Viking Hadrada, with his own claim to the throne, had crossed the North Sea and landed on the Northumbrian coast. King Harold, only months into his reign, with his men growing restless, faced war on two fronts, Hadrada in the north and William in the south. For William, it was the perfect moment to attack. But his fleet was stranded on the Norman coast, the winds against it. And then fate conspired to help him. Just as Harold turned north against the Vikings, the weather in Normandy changed. God, said William, has turned the winds around. On the 25th of September 1066, King Harold defeated the Vikings at Stamford Bridge. The next evening, while Harold was celebrating, William set sail from here, Saint-Valery. Halfway across the channel, there was near disaster. In the darkness, William's ship lost the others. But William calmed his men. He took dinner with them as if nothing had happened. By daybreak, the fleet was reunited. The Norman invasion of England was on course.
William's landing here in Pevensey Bay was unopposed. Striding ashore, he gathered up two handfuls of shingle and he cried out to his men, "See how I take the land of England with my bare hands." And proceeding into the Sussex countryside, still the Norman army found no opposition. William was on the scent of victory.
The invasion force was made up of more than just soldiers. There were porters, cooks, the full retinue of household staff. Saxon England was getting its first taste of orderly Norman life.
As soon as he heard about the Norman landings, Harold turned and headed southwards. He was almost too exhausted to contemplate another forced march, but he had reason to feel confident. His victory over the Vikings had buoyed him up. Defeating the Normans, that seemed like a simple operation. All he had to do was trap them down here in Sussex. Harold's tactical mistake was not to have rallied more troops. He came here to Senlac Hill to confront William with roughly equal numbers of men. So some 2,500 Saxon soldiers lined up on this ridge, presenting a solid wall with their shields. Battle commenced at 9 o'clock with a rousing cacophony of trumpets and much clattering of swords on shields. From the Saxons there were shouts of "Out! Out!" while from the Normans, cries of "Dieu aille," "God help us."
The Saxon position held firm. Wave upon wave of Norman troops struggled up the ridge, only to be repulsed by a barrage of spears, javelins, axes and stones. So tightly packed and solid were the Saxon ranks that, as one observer wrote, the dead could scarcely fall. Next, Harold ordered his men to advance.